When it comes to import performance, there's no doubt that the Honda and Acura brand are in a league of their own, particularly in terms of the cylinder head flow. It's hard to beat even a stock Honda cylinder head. We're here with Luke from 4Piston Racing. And 4Piston Racing are no strangers to the Honda brand, being involved with Honda engines at all levels of motorsport. In particular, their engines or cylinder heads are involved with setting records in the sport front-wheel drive class. In particular, their current record sits at a 793 at 189 mile an hour. Now, Luke, getting that sort of performance out of a stock B-series engine is obviously going to be challenging. You're also involved with the K-series engines. I want to start by talking about one of the products we've seen on your stand, which is the Billet CNC machine cylinder head for the K-series. Now, in its own right, the stock K-series cylinder head is no slouch, so where is the requirement to jump across to a full billet cylinder head?
A lot of the all-motor racing is alcohol, and we're getting to the point where we just need to turn more RPM, and we're out of airflow. So we're trying to squeeze big valves in there and port sizing for those valves that we're having trouble fitting in the stock castings. We're running into water. It's getting hard to machine. The head castings are getting older. A lot of junkyard stuff, and some of the heads are out of production. So the heads that we could fit big ports in are kind of going away. So we needed to get more airflow, more valve, and we needed to be able to put the camshafts in a position that work with those big valves so that we can get the valve timing correct.
Now, that's a good point you've just touched on there. In terms of fitting larger valves, I mean, in the general off-the-shelf sport compact market, it's pretty typical to take a 1mm oversized valve from the likes of maybe Faria, and generally those can be fitted in on the stock valve seats. But of course, there's a limit before you run out of valve seat or you have problems with valve-to-valve contact. So what have you done in the cylinder head to get around that?
So we've changed the valve angle to be able to fit a 5mm oversized valve on the intake side. And then we were able to straighten and change the shape of the exhaust port. We're still using the standard size exhaust valve, but in the past we were even shrinking those down to put bigger intake valves in. But because we were able to move the valve angle, now we have better separation and we can get our camshafts back where they need to be. But we also were able to straighten those port walls out and get a lot better exhaust flow, you know, 40 CFM increase over the factory exhaust port orientation.
In terms of changing the valve angle, obviously that's starting to get into the realms of a major modification to some of the factory geometry, and again, really obviously stuff that just can't be done with a factory head. Now, in terms of changing that valve angle or moving the valve centres, does that also necessitate you moving the location of the cams in the cylinder head?
Right now, we're able to work with the factory location of the cam. We can move it depending on how much change, but right now, only a couple of degrees of change is giving us a lot of flexibility on the cam position. So we are able to change the rocker arm more so than the cam location and get it where we need it to be.
In terms of making these modifications to the port shape, the combustion chamber shape, as well as the location of the valves, you're in the realms of basically infinite potential opportunities. Are you modeling this before you actually put a piece of billet in the CNC machine and start making a head, or is this a literal case of trial and error?
This is years of enlightened trial and error, what I call it. So we have a lot of experience with what to do, what is working, what doesn't work. And so we're pretty well guided on what we want to do without going into modeling. We can probably, most of the time, some of our ports are designed in computer programs. Most of them start from a hand port and somebody sitting in front of a flow bench or even a wet bench for many, many hours, for hundreds of hours, to come up with this over a long period of time. We've been working with these K-series engines probably since 2003. So it's just years of experience and knowing what we want to try. And then sometimes it's failing at it and trying to figure out what doesn't work.
I think that's a good point to make there, in so much as the cylinder head porting is certainly not something that I delve into. I like to leave that to professionals. But this is one of the areas that I'd sort of say that it's there's definitely a lot of science behind it, but there is a lot of art behind it as well. And I think this is one area where you really do need to work with someone who has a lot of experience with the particular cylinder head you're working with. Otherwise, you can take what is a stock, good flowing cylinder head and do something wrong with the port work and you can destroy it. Would that be fair?
Yeah, that's fair. And, you know, we set up guidelines and a set of rules that, as we've learned, these are the things we know that we need to be staying within this set of rules. And we know not to try some of the crazy things that are pretty out there.
In terms of fitting such a big valve into the K-Series block, do you have problems with the valve location in relation to the actual bore? Because I think that's probably something that a lot of people would overlook, but that obviously can become an issue.
Yeah, it can be. And in the early stages of the development of this, we kind of had the valves moved too far and got into the bore. And we still ran them like that with success. And we've gone back and moved things around a little more. That's part of the trial and error thing, and de-shrouded the valve a little bit more. But even with the valve shrouded up by the bore, it still outperformed everything we could do in the stock casting by leaps and bounds. So,
one of the focuses with head porting as well is sort of getting a nice smooth shape on that short turn radius, getting that airflow to really turn around there and go down through the valve. So a lot of people with a billet head have gone to the point of raising the intake ports in particular to get a straighter shot at the valve. Is that important, or is that not a necessity for you?
It is, and we do have limitations on raising the port, but we do have a specific port shape that we're after that may not be as tall as what you'd probably expect to see in a billet cylinder head. But it again goes back to trial and error and what we have found to work and what works in the RPM range that we're working with. And what we do on a 2-liter road race engine with regards to airspeed and what we do on a 2.7-liter alcohol engine is very different. A lot of times on these 4-valve cylinder heads, we're trying to slow air down to round the short turn and make sure that we're not creating a bunch of turbulence. And if we can slow some of that air down in certain areas and speed it up in other areas, we want a good even flow throughout the port. And if you measure airspeed in one part of that of a stock port, you'll find other areas of the port that are really slow going air. And if we can kind of get that to where we want it in every part of the port, that's what's going to work best for us. And we have a target number that we're looking for.
In terms of RPM you've just mentioned there, what sort of RPM are you running these engines to, and what is the usable RPM range? And let's talk here about maybe a drag application, something pretty extreme.
Yeah, in a drag application, we're going to be leaving the line somewhere between 7,000 and 7,800 RPM, depending on the condition of the track. And it's going to drop down into the high sixes. So we've got to have some kind of mid-range power to pull it back up. But then on gear changes, we're not going to drop below 8,300 RPM. We're going to run from 83 to 11.2. And we want to extend that power band as far as we can. We're limited on displacement, so we want more RPM as much as we can. So that's where we've gotten into needing bigger ports and bigger camshafts and really stretching that out. But we do have to have some low-end responsiveness where it's responsive as soon as we drop the clutch and it has to pull the car through a good track.
Now, the other thing with the sport front wheel drive class as well, you are limited to the turbocharger. So everyone's running essentially the same size turbocharger. So is this where maximizing the airflow through those ports as well as your cam profile really comes into its own?
Yeah, and valve timing is very important in sport front wheel drive, and making sure that the cylinder head is responsive. It's not just about going in and having a great big port that flows a lot of CFM. We really run into port sizing becoming critical on the turbo cars even more so, because we've got to stay in the efficiency range of that turbocharger. And when we're on gear changes, you know, we're not allowed to have sequentials, but we do have strain gauges with, you know, no one's clutching these cars. They're shifted pretty quickly, but the responsiveness and keeping it in full boost, keeping this thing above 60 pounds of boost the whole way down the track is the key. So I think that's where we've found some advantages, is that our cylinder heads are a little more responsive and keep in the meat of the power band the whole way. We have the most average horsepower going down the whole track.
I think a lot of people, when they're looking at flow numbers off a flow bench, think that more is more, but really that is only part of the whole story when it comes to how that head's going to perform when you actually put it onto the dyno.
It is true, and it's hard to look at people look at a flow chart and it looks a lot like a dyno chart, and they think that it's going to correlate, and sometimes it doesn't. Many times it doesn't. It's not a dyno chart. So when you're looking at losing, sometimes you may lose low lift flow or gain low lift flow, and it doesn't matter too much. It may have lost there and gained up top and perform outstanding, depending on what you're doing. So you have to design it for the cam profile, for the induction. It's a whole system that has to work together.
Back onto the billet cylinder head, the other aspect there with the billet cylinder head, you are literally starting with a solid block of alloy and it's got no water jacket in it. So this obviously isn't going to be suitable for your daily driver, but for drag applications running on methanol, the cooling isn't so much of an issue. You know, talk to us a little bit about that, and does that billet cylinder head with no water jacket also improve the ability to seal the head to the block?
It does for sure. It's not moving around as much. It's not as temperamental to temperature change, so we don't need to cool it. Even when we're not on methanol, even when we're on our class mandated turbo fuel, which is C85, VPC 85, we still don't have a problem controlling the temperature. We're still running water through the block, but it's helping quite a bit in sealing the head gaskets and just keeping things from moving around. But we actually have trouble getting heat into it, and so we'll idle them a little bit longer to get the block heated up and then run down the track. This size of cylinder head is not really suited for other types of racing. So we're not gonna have this on a road race car. It's way too big of a port, it's way too aggressive, it would be a dog. So I know a lot of people have looked at the billet and said, I want that on my car. Oh, there's no water jackets. You know, I can't have that on my road race car. Well, it would be a dog on that road race car. This is for high RPM, extremely high horsepower. The engines that these are going on to make over 500 horsepower naturally aspirated. At 11,000 RPM. It's not going to work in our circuit 2-liter road race car.
Yeah, I think that's another aspect. A lot of people think that it's a one-size-fits-all, but really you do actually have to design and develop the entire engine for a particular application if you want to get the best results out of that engine. Just talking about the block, we've obviously focused on the head there, and as is common with most import engines or a lot of engines these days that are coming out, the block in the Honda, both the B series and the K series, is alloy. Not an issue obviously in stock form, but particularly in high boost applications this becomes a weak point. So how are you addressing the block strength? You don't see a need to go billet there?
On the K series right now, there aren't blocks cracking. Even with huge turbos over 80 millimeters making more than 1500 horsepower, the blocks are holding together. The B series, some guys have found limitations. You guys are all probably very familiar with Speed Factory. They run more than 100 pounds of boost on their B series, and they are running billet blocks. And that's because with that kind of boost pressure, cylinder pressure, they have found the limitations of the stock block. The K series, not so much yet, but there's also not a lot of people pushing the limits like that at 2,000 horsepower. And so there will be a market for billet blocks, and it's just going to be guys finding that limit and pushing over 2,000 horsepower with these little four cylinders. A lot of the class racing you're looking at more in the 1,300 to 1,400 horsepower range. There's not a lot of issue with splitting blocks. A lot of the tune-ups are really good. A lot of the tuners are getting better. The computers are better now. So it's easier for guys to monitor the critical parameters that are going to keep these things alive.
So at that point, sort of in the 1,300, 1,400, 1,500 horsepower vicinity, a good set of ductile iron sleeves is sufficient?
Absolutely, yeah. And not all sleeves are created equal. Some of them move around more, some of them are softer, some of them have more support in the block. So we try to stick with a sleeve that's got a lot of meat to it. And that may work great in this drag race application, but might have cooling effects for an endurance application. So we have to pick the sleeve that's going to be suited for that particular type of racing. It may be a really thick, rigid sleeve for drag race and 65 pounds of boost, but in something that's going to be 30 pounds of boost and run in a time attack or maybe even a 24-hour endurance race, we might have to give up some of that sleeve structure in order for better cooling.
Okay, so I think one of the other issues we often see when people go to an aftermarket ductile iron sleeve is that they do that to fix the bore strength, which is great, but a lot of the time we also see that that brings in a brand new problem, which is the sleeves dropping in use and then the head gasket leaking. And this is a common theme we hear across a lot of people using these sleeves. So can you talk to us about that and how do you fix that? Why is this a problem we hear about?
It is installation related. So if you have a good process and you are good with your machine and you have a good operator and you're doing things right and installing the sleeve properly where they don't move around and you let them set and get them into position, they're not going to drop. You're not going to drop a sleeve. So you can do thousands of blocks and never have a dropped sleeve if the installation process is done right.
So basically you have the right equipment and read the instructions?
Yes, read the instructions. No one wants to read the instructions. Everyone throws those away and then tries it on their own, right?
That's pretty important when you're talking about a finished engine that's going to run out to thousands and thousands of dollars. Look, it's been great to get some insight into your engine components. If someone wants to get in touch with you, how can they reach out?
4piston.com, and we are on Instagram at 4piston cylinder heads and Facebook at 4piston.
That's great. Look, thanks for your time.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.